It is 7, so I'm going to start the meeting. Obviously, I'm hoping other board members join us because I don't have everyone here yet. I'll do a roll call. I see Barry Miller, Liz Rosen, Howard Kagan, Jeff Collins, Linda Lover, Caroline Jerome is not here yet, Dorothea Marcus is not here yet, Leslie Gerber is not here yet, Marcia is here, Kevin is here, and Roz is here. So we do have quorum, that is correct, right? 1, 2, 3, 7, 8, that is quorum. Okay, so first on the agenda is a motion to adopt the agenda. Any discussion on the motion to adopt? Or is there a motion? Can I get a motion to adopt the agenda?
I make a motion to adopt the agenda.
Get a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you. All in favor of adopting the agenda?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, next is the consent agenda. I'll read the consent agenda. It is to approve the minutes of the February 17, 2022 board meeting, to approve the 2021 annual report to the state submitted on February 25th, 2022, to appoint Michael Lamunier, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong, to the position of senior clerk at $18.51 an hour, to approve payment to Advantage Archive for digitizing Woodstock Times 2004 to 2020 for $14,775, to approve the vouchers numbered 28680 through 28713, to approve the updated library social media policy, to approve the updated wireless access to the internet policy, to approve the updated temporary safety practices policies, and to revoke the phased reopening policy. So the first question is, does any board member wish to remove one of the items from the consent agenda and discuss it?
I just need a point of clarity. I want to talk about the safety practices policy or the phased reopening plan. And I'm not sure which covers the masking issues directly.
Okay.
Because that's what I want to discuss, is the masking issue.
Okay, so we'll remove both those items from the consent agenda.
Thank you.
Yep. Any other items from the consent agenda that the board would like to discuss? Okay, so I need a motion to approve the consent agenda items 1 through 7.
I make a motion to, are you making a motion?
No, I would like someone else to make the motion.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the consent agenda from 1 to 7.
I'll double it, I'll say.
Okay, all in favor of approving the consent agenda items 1 through 7. I have something at my door, let me see who that is.
Aye.
Aye.
I'm the only one here, so I got to get it. Be right back.
Temporarily lost Jeff, and Dorothea, I think, should be entering now, too.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, sorry everyone, I had to get the door. Okay, so let's, we did approve the consent agenda, correct, before I walked out? Up to 1 through 7. So item 8, to approve the updated temporary safety practices policy, we're gonna have a discussion on that. Kevin, I think you wanted to know if that was the masking policy, is that correct?
Yes, I think that's what he said.
Yes. Yes, that's correct. Sorry.
Yeah, I can step in here. Do you want to talk about this now, or should we talk about it when we get down to the policy committee report?
We should do it now, actually.
Okay. Well, Barry, do you want to say anything, or should I take this?
Why don't you start, and then if I have something to
sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So the temporary safety practices policy. It had already been revised a few times over the past year or so. And so what we did with the policy was we just rearranged it so that the portions of it that are still in action and relevant are moved to the top, and everything else, it hasn't been deleted. It's just stricken through to indicate these aren't things we have to follow right now. But the big change to that right now would be lifting the mask requirement in the library. So we changed the language in the policy. Here, I think I can quickly jump down to it, hopefully. Yeah. Can you all see this?
Yes.
Okay. So we changed the language. This, all of this that I'm scrolling through hasn't changed. The section that changed is here. We will not be requiring masks to be worn in at all times inside the library. We changed the language here because we do want to retain the ability to ask people to wear masks when we're having programs as needed. So the effect of this would be that it's masks are optional in the library for most situations, but if we're having a program in an enclosed space with many people, then we, you know, we can still ask people to wear masks for that. And then, yeah, the rest of this is just kind of doing cleanup on this policy and moving all of the pieces that had already been stricken through to the bottom so that we don't have to, so the policy is just a bit clearer to understand. And then the other piece I think that Kevin asked about was the phased reopening plan. Let me go back up to the top. And so that was a plan that was created in response to the governor's requirement that we have this phased reopening plan. But that whole sort of bureaucratic structure isn't being enforced anymore. So this plan is just obsolete at this point. So again, we're not gonna throw it away. We just aren't, we're not required to follow it right now. That's what's being proposed.
Okay, I have a question.
Go ahead, Howard.
So what you're saying is you're proposing that the library adopt the policy to drop the any kind of mask mandate in the library at this point going forward. Is that what I understand?
Right.
What happens? Optional. Okay. What happens if it's optional? So does this mean that in let's say in 2 weeks from now, if the infection rate starts to climb again, can we reinstate the mask policy?
Yes. There's a clause in our policy that says that we can at any time change any of the language in the policy to suit the moment. If things change. There is a paragraph in the written into the policy that says that.
Is there, is it stated anywhere that the mask, the requirement for wearing masks is going to be based on anything like of an infection rate or some other CDC recommendation or?
CDC recommendations.
Okay, so that's what we're going to be basing it on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions on the temporary safety practices policy?
No, then.
Okay, so can someone make a motion to approve the updated temporary safety practices policy?
Well, I just want to say that I object to no masks at this point in time. So I guess I would just vote no for this then. Is that right?
That would be the process if we're through this. I mean, obviously. Yeah, that's a discussion that you can have if you want to have more discussion about it, Kevin. It's really.
Yeah, I'm just concerned. I run a conference center locally, regionally, and I've been looking at many other models. I'm not sure what other libraries are doing, but other public venues, music venues, theaters, et cetera, and they're all still requiring masks regardless of the CDC changes. And at the ones I've researched, and that's mostly in Rosendale, Kingston, and in Woodstock as well. And I just think I could go another month maybe, but there's a lot of language coming out that by the end of April, we're gonna probably see the rise that people are seeing in Europe and China right now. I don't know. I'm not an expert. I'm just feeling cautious about it and concerned that we're jumping too fast. And that's all I have to say, I guess, really.
Yeah, I guess I feel the same way about it that Kevin does.
Yeah. If I can just jump in here for a second, I agree with both Howard and Kevin. From the time that we worked on this until today, things have changed. And it's only a week. Does everybody here know Kimberly Kay?
Yeah, I do. No, I do.
Kimberly posted today on Facebook that she ended up testing positive for COVID. And she's vaccinated. She wears a mask. So when I read that, it made me pause as to this invisible disease that seems to be striking at unknown moments and times. So I think the idea that we're leaving it optional, if you feel safer with the mask on, leave your mask on. Hmm. Because I think the reason that we went this way is there are a lot of people who are anxious to not wear the mask anymore because they feel safe. Mm-hmm. We can't be the overseers for everybody. We can only be the overseer for the library and for the patrons that come to the library. So I take the things that Kevin and Howard say to heart. And when we get to passing that, we're not passing it, we can at that time decide whether we want to follow through and leave the new plan in place or remain with the old plan, leaving masks on. How does everybody feel about that?
I would like to, Starthea here. I would like to ask Ivy how the staff feel about this. I gather, you know, what I'm finding is that, you know, things, there's like a tipping point. And it seems in the last few weeks, I'm seeing fewer and fewer masks around. And I don't know where Kevin researched, but I mean, at Upstate Films now, they're no longer requiring that you wear a mask. You know, when I go to a place like Adams, you know, every time I go there, there's fewer people wearing masks. I still wear my mask. But I think maybe if it was clearer that if there are programs upstairs in the enclosed area, that those maybe there should be a sign on the door there about masks required in this space, which may not have the new ventilation systems we have in the rest of the library. But I also think that Woodstock is a pretty mask compliant population. I mean, there's a lot of older people in Woodstock, and I think people have generally been very comfortable with wearing masks. And I think I would imagine most of our patrons would probably still wear masks and, you know, would feel safe. And the staff may continue to wear masks, but I don't know, the moment, you know, I'm not an expert. I mean, I could go either way with it, but I think, you know, people are starting to kind of try to live life more normally, and that they know what to do if rates go up again. And also, I mean, when Barry mentioned this person, yeah, lots of people who are vaccinated are getting breakthrough infections, but they're often just have symptoms like for a day or something. I mean, it's, you know, it's not like this is an endemic thing. It's not a pandemic anymore at this point, and it could become one again.
One second. Can I ask people to raise hands and have me call on you so we don't just speak out? And actually, let's do the Zoom hands because that way I know the order of them. Okay. Kevin, you're next, and then Liz, and then Howard is my current order. Okay.
Great. I just feel, you know, one of the venues is the barn, and requiring masks on a local basis, as well as that vaccination status, knowing that. But I think that's the biggest concern I have is the fact that we can't require people to have a vaccination in order to come into the library. That's not our policy. But requiring a mask for an additional amount of time until we have another 30 days or so, I think is our responsibility as a policymaking board to protect our staff and patrons.
Liz, you're up if you're done, Kevin.
Okay. You know, I certainly understand the concern, and I'm continuing to wear my mask. I do believe the staff is beginning to get some pushback from patrons because the official mandates in the state and the CDC have been saying you don't have to wear the mask. And what I'm wondering is if the infection rates at the moment are fairly low, if we should and maybe I would like to add something to this motion that this is a policy to be reviewed every month. In other words, if infection rates go up, we know that that each month at the board meeting, we are looking at where we are and deciding what to do, you know, what to do then.
Is that an official request for an amendment?
That's a question, yes.
Okay. I'll second that.
Okay.
Well, I think.
Howard, you're up next.
I think rather than have the board make that decision on a monthly basis, I think it should be made by the staff on the basis of the infection rate on a daily basis. Because to give you a perspective, the infection rate in New York City is around 1 or less than 1%. In Ulster County, I think I checked it yesterday, it was around 2%. And I was at a play yesterday in the city, and the theaters on Broadway, even though the infection rates are at 1%, they're requiring a vaccination and mask wearing throughout the performance. So there's some perspective. It seems to me that if the infection rate, especially in Ulster County being 2%, that's not really very low. And it seems to me that if the infection rate is at 1.2% is from the medical advice that I've been hearing, 1.2% is a good rate for not requiring masks. Once it gets over 1.2%, experts are saying that mask wearing is a good safety measure. And we're not at 1.2% in Ulster County yet.
Ivy, you next. Marcia, if you want to put your hand up, please use your Zoom hand so I can get you in the queue.
Okay.
Thank you.
I just wanted to kind of, I guess, backstep a little bit and talk about what this policy has been tied to, which is CDC guidelines. And CDC right now says that transmission is low, and so we don't have to wear masks. And like, we might have all these other, you know, things that we can point to anecdotally, but in terms of enforcing a policy, it's been very helpful for our staff to be able to say what the CDC says we should do, that's what we do. And that way you get ahead of people who want to question your every move. So I guess I'm hesitant to start a system where it's on the staff to every day be looking at percentages and making the call. It's much clearer, I think, for us and the public to say, okay, when the CDC said things were bad, we had masks. When the CDC says things are better, we don't. And you always have the option. You not only have the option of wearing a mask inside the library, but you have the option of the walk-up window. We have home delivery. So, I mean, it's not like we're doing everything we can to not restrict service, but I think we also have to be aware of what this experience is like for the average patron on the street who just wants a decision either way, sort of. And they don't want to have to be paying attention to what the latest level is. They just want a clear message from the library about what they should be doing.
With you?
I just wanted to ask, Ivy, you had mentioned at one point that that our policy was modeled somewhat after the Saugerties Library policy. So I wondered if you could, you know, because Kevin was saying, what are other libraries doing? I think it would be helpful to talk a little about, you know, in general, are libraries still requiring masks and what is the Saugerties policy?
Right, yeah. So all over Ulster County in Mid-Hudson system, it's a little bit all over the map. There are a lot of libraries that, you know, as soon as the governor lifted the mask mandate a month ago, they lifted their mask mandates. And I think those libraries were seeing more pushback from their communities to do so. So it's really changes on a library by library basis. But when the policy committee met earlier this month to talk about this change, we kind of modeled our approach on what we saw Saugerties doing, which is pretty much what I've proposed, where it's the message is it's mask optional so that people who want to wear masks, of course, should still feel completely comfortable doing that. And then they also, in terms of their programming, it's kind of on a case-by-case basis. So when they put up the, you know, the little banners announcing a program, they'll tell you if it's a program where you have to wear a mask or if it's one where you don't. So they, you know, it gives us the flexibility to make sure that we are protecting, you know, more vulnerable populations like unvaccinated children or older populations, but it's not as alienating to everybody else, I guess. So that's kind of, yeah, that's where we sort of look to for guidance. And also they're one of our closest neighbors. So we can kind of look to them to see, okay, is this working for you? Geographically, we're sort of in the same boat as them.
Okay, Marsha, I saw your hand before I saw Kevin's hand. So you go next and then I'll get Kevin.
I spent a long Zoom call with a consortium of unions that work in the film industry about lifting some sort of mask mandates. And they chose not to do it for another month. And they have very strict policies and they still want to test 4 times a week, which is how Kimberly Kay found out that she was positive because she was working on a film test, got tested. And even though she was asymptomatic, she found out that she was positive. And this is just one industry. And I know that it doesn't really cross over to the library, but there's still businesses and other places that require masks. If you go into a doctor's office, you're required to wear a mask. I know everyone doesn't want to wear a mask anymore. I don't, but we should wait one more month and see what's going on.
Hey, Kevin, you're next.
Great, thank you. So I thank you all for this good discussion also. And just wanted to say, I don't think it should reside with staff. I believe it's the board's responsibility to make this policy, regardless of what the CDC is saying and et cetera. I think that's what the staff has for them is our board policy is, and people can reach out to us, I believe. I don't think we should wait for the board to convene to adjust this policy though. I think Ivy, you need to have that capacity to send an email and say, I want to do, you know, somehow more quickly than waiting for our monthly meeting, if appropriate. And regarding the Saugerties Library comparison, which I think it's nice, their population is even larger, but I think their space is larger and fully renovated. And I think it's a little apples and oranges. I don't think it's apples and apples to look at their setup compared to ours. That's all. And I think just another month is exactly what I was thinking, Marcia, as well, is just give it another month, because that's everything I'm seeing is by the end of April, if we don't see this rise within our area, then we're looking pretty strong. But it's just a little bit premature. And that's based on our local pharmacist, Neil, who's given over 36,000 vaccinations in our area. Thank you.
Any other comments? So the motion is to approve the temporary safety practices policy. If you feel that it should be, and it's been amended to say that it will be revisited within at each board meeting for the foreseeable future. So if you would like to approve it, vote yes. If you'd like to not approve it, leave it the way it is today, vote no. Is that clear? Is a vote clear? Basically, if we approve the temporary safety practices policy, we're removing the mask mandate. If we don't approve it, we're not removing the mask mandate. That's my understanding of this vote. Correct? Okay. So all in favor of approving updated temporary safety practices policy? I see 1, 2, 3 board votes. All opposed to updating the temporary safety practices policy. I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm abstaining as the chair. So the vote is 3-5 to not approve the temporary safety practices policy. So we are keeping the existing version of the temporary safety practices policy in effect. Okay. Moving on to the Jeff, motion. Yes, go ahead.
Just one more thing, because we asked this question before to Ivy, I guess. This was discussed with the staff. I know we just voted, but I just want to make this clear. Can you tell us what the staff said?
No, I'm not going to go there because we've already voted on this. We need to move on to other items in the agenda.
All right.
Okay. So next item is to revoke the phased opening plan. Can I get a motion to do that for discussion purposes?
I move that we revoke the phased opening plan.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, motioned and seconded it. Any discussion on the motion to revoke the phased reopening plan? Howard.
Does that affect the mask policy at all, the phased reopening?
No,
okay.
Any further discussion? All in favor of revoking the phased reopening plan? Any opposed? I see none opposed. So that passes. Okay, moving on, director's report. Ivy. Liz, is your hand up for it to vote or your hand up to speak?
Okay, can you guys see my screen? This is kind of large, but I mean, I don't have a whole lot to add to this report. I did want to make sure everybody saw the photo of the knitting group that we had in person in the library last week. So that was really exciting to have a buzz of activity in the building again. And then just, yeah, to kind of draw your attention to all of the programming that we're sort of cooking up for the spring and summer. We were chosen to be part of the Library of Local cohort for this next year, which will give us access to a lot of cool, fun tools to sort of help spread, community resiliency in the face of climate change and stuff like that. So we'll be getting a seed library that will come fully stocked. We'll get a collection of books, and we'll also have access to a lot of programming on those themes. So we're excited about that. Otherwise, a lot of this is covered elsewhere in the agenda. We submitted the annual report that was already approved. I did want to point out, I'll be away from the library that first week of April. So I am going to be asking the Facilities and Planning Committee to change our usual meeting time to accommodate that. Everything else is basically in the report, but I'm happy to answer any questions anybody might have.
Dorothea.
I have a question that while you're away, Ivy, mm-hmm. are you deputizing any particular staff person to sort of be in charge, or does it change by the day depending who's in, or what's the procedure?
That's a good question. Kim is the natural deputy, yeah. So I'll make sure I talk to her about that, and then she works Tuesday through Saturday, so that leaves a Monday that she's not there, but now that Michael is senior clerk, I think he's probably the natural person to be head of the library that day. So I'll make sure I have conversations with both of them about any.
And and also that, you know, be good for the board to know in case any board member has any concern while you're away, they know who to call.
Right, right.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. I can send out an email before I go to make all of this clear to everybody.
So there's a note in the text that we need to record the trustees who voted each way. We'll check the video to ensure that we get those names right. Okay. We're on financial reports. Liz Rosen, you have the floor. Oh, and you're muted, Liz.
Sorry. We've already approved the vouchers, and the most unusual one there was the voucher for B-Dry, which we had thought we would receive in the prior budget year, which is when we budgeted for it. So it's going to hits our budget this year. Otherwise, on the budget to actual, we've received the tax payment, and there's nothing really remarkable. We're pretty much on track. There are a couple of things that get paid up at the front of the year, but otherwise, it's really fairly much on track. The balance sheet shows our bank balance reflecting the payment from the town. And so we're in good shape there. On the capital fund, we have basically no activity so far this month. We have the legal fees that we paid, I believe it was last month, and our balance in the capital fund is $14,121. And you'll see there's other current assets for $33,000, which is what we've spent on our preparation for the new building. Are there any questions?
Yeah. Right. I don't see any questions. Do you want to move on to your motions, Liz?
Okay. And we're making motions to adjust the budget lines. Let me get down to it.
It's on the screen, Liz, also.
Oh, okay. Yes, I keep looking. I've got three screens open. So we're moving budget items to pay for the archival work that came in. We're going to take for the digitization. So we're taking $3,000 from professional fees, others $3,500 from contingency, $1,000 from archival, $2,500 from recordings. And well, you can read it. It's but that is to move budget items around to pay for the digitization of the Woodstock Times. And we have a second motion.
Let's just go with the first motion initially. So that's a motion from Liz. Is there a second for that?
I'll second it.
Okay, the motion has been made and seconded to move funds from other budget lines to budget item 74.15. Other non-book to pay for the Woodstock Times digitization. That includes $3,000 from professional fees, $3,500 from contingency, $1,000 from archival, $2,500 from recordings, discs and tapes, and $2,275 from juvenile programs. Is there discussion on this? Mm-hmm. I do not see discussion, so all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? I see none opposed. Any abstentions? No abstentions. Okay, Liz, next motion.
Next motion is to move 2006-2159 from salaries other staff to A908-9.8 for compensated absences. This is the payout of vacation pay to for Jessica. And we're under, and we have been short a clerk, so we're under in other staff salaries.
Okay.
So I
go ahead.
I make a motion that we approve that.
Great. Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
So okay. Howard first. Any discussion?
Was that Kevin who seconded?
Howard, actually.
Okay.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? None opposed. Any abstentions? No abstentions. Okay, Liz.
Okay, the third motion is to move $100 from 72-220 other to 74-413A periodicals other. So we pay all our periodicals at the beginning of the year, and we were $100 over. So this is
okay.
I'll second that motion.
Made the motion. Kevin seconded it. Any discussion? All in favor of moving $100 from other to periodicals?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Okay, none opposed. Anything else, Liz? And financial reports?
No, unless anyone has any questions.
Okay, we'll move ahead to facilities and planning. Howard, you have the floor.
We did not have a facilities meeting on the scheduled day, as I was on vacation at the time, so I don't have a report, but we will meet next, the first Thursday in April.
Wonderful, thank you.
Next meeting.
Policy, Barry, you have the floor.
All right, well, we just took care of some of it. We reviewed the wireless access to the internet and the library social media policies. There were a couple of very small changes in language, and both, I'd like to make a motion to update both of those.
I think we have to see what the changes are before we can.
Well, we actually already did it with the consent agenda, didn't we?
I thought so, yes.
Yes, we did.
Yep, okay, cool. So that's anything else, Barry?
No, because we just talked about the phased reopening plan. So that's been taken care of in conversation.
Okay.
Jeff, can I?
Yeah.
I just want to say something while. To help Marcia with the minutes. I'm not seeing Leslie Gerber. I'm not seeing whether you raised your hand or not. And when we did the vote on the mask thing, Jeff, you abstained and you said it was 5-3, but there are 10 trustees. There are 10 trustees here. I think Caroline's the only one missing, correct?
Correct.
So I don't know if how Leslie voted on those things. You know, maybe if he missed his vote, or maybe Marcia caught it.
I didn't catch it. I didn't have Leslie in that. I'm going to have to double check.
Can he now state what his vote is, or is it just treated as an abstention?
I meant to abstain on the Woodstock Times issue because I was a writer for the paper during that time, and I feel I have an interest in it. Okay. I meant to vote yes on the mask issue.
Okay. So it'd be 5-4 then. Is that correct? Is a proper vote count?
Right.
Yes.
Okay. Right. Okay.
I'm still abstaining.
Okay. Anything else I missed?
Nope.
I don't know, but that was the only, that was a close vote. So.
It was a close vote.
Okay.
So raise that hand, Leslie.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're past policies, so old business update on 10 Dixon Avenue. Okay, so here's the update on 10 Dixon Ave. We have finished the phase one environmental assessment form or environmental assessment. The engineers have strongly suggested to do a phase two to cover a couple items that they wanted to look at more carefully. I believe it's the correct thing to do the phase two. I don't want to go against environmental engineers and say don't do what they suggest. Our lawyers also strongly suggest to do the phase two to make sure that we cover ourselves in case there's any liability. So I am suggesting that we all do the phase two. And so we do have a motion which is not in the agenda because we got the contract at 3 o'clock this afternoon for the phase two. So we'll do that. Probably first makes sense to do that because the other two motions are based on that one. So the motion that I will make is to authorize $17,500 to be paid to do phase two environmental assessment form to Collier Engineers.
I'll second that.
Okay. So let me cover that first. So that's made and seconded. Let me discuss the actual work that needs to be done and a little bit about why we're doing this. So the building had a phase two done in 2012. Our engineers feel that they wanted to get more information in that phase two that was done in 2012. It's basically concerning some dry wells that were there when it was an industrial building. They want to make sure that they understand what, if anything, is in those dry wells and how it's affecting the soil. Those dry wells are 18 feet below the ground. They're not going to affect anybody at the surface, but they just want to see what's happening below the ground. The next thing they want to check is that there was a burn pit decades ago. It got covered over. They want to check what's in the burn pit and make sure that that's okay. And then the last thing they want to do is they want to do some tests around the septic and leach field to make sure that if anyone poured something down the drain 30 plus years ago or whatever, that it's not contaminating the ground. So those are the things they're doing. I just want to say that this is out of a huge abundance of caution. We do not expect any problems with this. We do not expect there to be any issues with this, but we feel like it's important to make sure that there are no issues around this. And this will take so that the schedule for this is that we will have the wells, the holes drilled on the 28th to check the underground areas. We'll get the test samples on the 29th. They'll take 10 days to be tested and get the results. We could expedite the test results if we paid double the amount of the test results. I don't want to do that. It's too much money. So that's what I know, and I'm totally open to questions because it's a lot of information.
That's in terms of the tests for the dry wells?
The dry wells. Dry wells are all
so it would be around April 9th or 10th that we would have those results probably.
Yes.
What about the burn pit and the septic investigation?
All the same. The test results for all would come in the same time. We'd have the knowledge at the same time.
Okay.
Kevin, and let's raise hands and Zoom hands too again, just so that I can get a sequential.
Yeah, Kevin. Thank you. Yes, thank you. So I just, for points of clarity, the existing owner, I'm assuming it's, I'm calling it Anderson, but that's whoever the existing owner is. What's their liability in this process? Is there any? How does it impact our purchase contract? And in order for them to have done all the work that they did to renovate that building and expand it, was none of this done? It's not clear to me.
Yeah, it was done, and they did it in a manner that is appropriate for a commercial building, an office building. As a library, I think that we have a higher level of liability than they might have. We have more people there that are, we have young kids there. We have a larger, so we do need to do more extensive testing. That's kind of the the belief behind this. And
okay.
You know, and again, I don't expect any problems. They did do a test. They did find just a little bit, you know, they did, you know, we're just doing more exhaustive tests. I really feel like this is an abundance of caution that we're trying to get through here.
I think it's a responsible move, Jeff. I just yeah. wanted those clarity. So thank you.
Yeah. And again, it's a different use structure. It's an office that people come in, go to the office, they're not going to be outside. Whereas we have people that might be outside. And that's kind of a difference in how we're, you know, why we're doing this. Any other questions? Okay, so seeing no other questions, I will call for a vote on the motion to authorize $17,500 to be paid to do. Oh, is your hand up, Dorothea? You're on mute. You're still on mute, Dorothea.
Sorry, I was taking time to do the raised hand. That's why you didn't see it right away.
Okay.
I don't know if we need to discuss this now or after the vote, just what you predict a timeline going forward from April 10th in terms of a bond vote and stuff. But I mean, we can go ahead and vote on this.
It's a good part of the question. If it does affect, yeah. I mean, if it affects yeah. the timeline for the vote and the timeline for the so our expectation is will be done by between the testing, the drilling, the taking of the samples, the 10 days of the testing, and then the time it takes them to write the reports, that can all be finished by April 20th, April 19th, April 20th, by that kind of time, like mid to late April. So I don't think we could do a vote around April 19th. We could probably do a vote a few weeks later than that. We don't need to wait to get the results to schedule a vote. We do need to wait to get the results to hold the vote, if that makes sense. So we could schedule it earlier than, I mean, we could schedule it for a time after we know we're going to have the results. That way we don't lose a month waiting for the results to come in before we schedule a vote.
But how much time does the Board of Elections need, you know, lead time in terms of printing ballots and-
2 weeks.
You know, what?
2 weeks, it's a couple of weeks. We can call a vote in 13 days.
Okay, but we of course need the public education campaign and stuff.
I understand all that. Yeah. You know, yeah.
But, I'm wondering why does it take if they're gonna have the sample results, you know, 10 days, maybe it's 10 business days after March 29th. You know, it takes that long, you know, wouldn't we know even if they haven't done the official report yet, if they had found anything?
We would know after the 10 days. But we wouldn't have the official report. I mean, assuming that they tell our engineer, which the engineer can then tell us.
Right. So I'm just thinking, you know, like April 10th is a lot sooner than April 20th with a very tight timeline. So, you know,
like. I'm not sure what you're suggesting, Dorothea.
Oh, what I'm saying is it sounds like we will know earlier than April 20th if it's okay to go ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you know, even if we don't have the official report.
Correct.
It gives us a little more breathing room. That's all I'm saying.
We do need to talk about how and when to schedule the vote and how this impacts it. I'm not ready to do that now until we actually pass this, first of all, and then see how that affects it. So any other discussion on authorizing the $17,500 for the phase two? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so the next piece is to transfer $20,000 from the general fund balance to the building fund to pay for the phase two environmental assessments. This covers, I put $20,000 in because I wasn't sure what the money was gonna be until just this afternoon. So I still think we should leave the $20,000 in case there's other additional costs. Obviously, if there isn't, we won't use it, but. Any discussion on this?
What was the amount in the contract?
17.5.
Okay.
Any discussion on this? Oh, is there a second, first of all?
I'll second it.
Thank you. That was Barry. So no further discussion. All in favor of transferring $20,000 from the general fund, fund balance to the building fund to pay for phase two environmental assessments?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, next is a motion to approve the memorandum of understanding to be presented to the Woodstock Town Board. Okay, that's in your document packet. Basically, the memorandum of understanding says that as a, if you can see the letter here, it's a bill, that as a municipality, we feel it's appropriate to get a memorandum of understanding between the town and us to allow us to move forward with the project. Basically what this is a, let me just try to explain it. We have an issue with the zoning code, right? We're not allowed to be a library in the LI zoning code. So the intention of this is to basically say legally, we don't have to follow town zoning code. However, we're going to do all the processes that we need to do for the town. We're going to go to the planning board. We're going to listen to them. We're going to take their comments and listen to their comments and react to their comments. But this gets us legally able to say that we can move ahead before the zoning code is changed to allow libraries in a light industrial zone. So, and this is all, this is, it's more about getting, making sure the time frame is expedited. At the same time, I believe concurrently to this, the planning board is discussing libraries being able to be in light industrial zones, even as we speak, on their meeting. So this is a process that is moving forward. This is to make sure that we don't have to wait for, you know, that we are okay timing-wise. The other part of this is that we will have a public hearing, I believe, with the planning board, and where we will assure them that we will take their input and we will honor their input into any process that we do, you know, through the construction process. Are there questions on this? I don't want this to sound like we're trying to avoid doing the right thing. I want this to be clear that this isn't a way to expedite what we're doing while still working with the town in a responsible way. Any other questions? Dorothea.
Yeah, hi. You said now you think the public hearing will be with the planning board?
Yeah, I talked with Bill this morning. He thinks it's appropriate to be with the planning board.
Okay, yeah. And then at what point would the town board, if we approve this tonight, at what point does the town board approve it? After the public hearing?
They are planning to discuss it and I think vote on it on Tuesday. It's on the Tuesday agenda, next week's agenda.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor of the approval to approve the memorandum of understanding to be presented to the Woodstock Town Board?
Aye.
Aye. Was that seconded, Jeff?
It was seconded, yeah. I think, by Barry.
I did, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Aye.
Unless we use the positive on that. Okay. So, and then I just want to have a little more discussion, just open discussion about what's happening at 10 Dixon Ave and what the process is from here. We do need to get a vote date set. We do need to make sure that we get that done as expeditiously as possible. I think that we, you know, and I need to talk to our lawyers, and I need to think about the idea of planning for a vote. Do we schedule a vote now, knowing the approximate schedule of the EAF, of the second phase two EAF? That's going to be the gating item, getting the results for that. Do we schedule it now, knowing that, or do we wait until after we get the results before we schedule it? If we do that, then it's going to be much later in the calendar and give us less time to prepare for that. So those are the trade-offs. Dorothea.
Yeah, I think we schedule it now because I think we have people who are, you know, ready and eager to support the library and the bond campaign. And we need time to you know, we were hoping to be able to do even public open houses in the building, you know, for people once Miller Howard has moved out, you know, or with their permission before they've moved out. But I think there's a lot of, you know, I think we need as much lead time as possible. And, you know, if some terrible environmental thing came up, which we're not expecting, you know, it could be postponed. But I think, you know, it would be better to start, you know, planning and, you know, give ourselves a reasonable amount of time to do this. I'm also concerned about, I believe our purchase agreement with Miller Howard is to, you know, is to complete the purchase by June 30th?
That's correct.
Okay. So I don't know, you know, if the bond passes on May 15th or something, or May 20th, I don't know how much time it takes for that transaction to be completed in terms of the bonding and the money. I'm assuming that, you know, if it couldn't be done by June 30th, that, you know, that that Miller Howard would, if the bond had passed, you know, wouldn't, you know, be a stickler about the deadline, but I don't know. You know, I just don't know how long it takes to make it a reality.
I'll answer part of that question. May 30th is a hard deadline. May 30th is a hard deadline. We can't go past that.
Okay, well then I definitely think we should schedule the bond vote now.
Okay, any other discussion? Do we have a suggested date for the bond vote?
Let me get my calendar.
Before Memorial Day, certainly, right? So yeah. first week in May, Jeff, is that realistic?
Yeah.
And if that May 30th is a hard date.
No, June 30th.
June 30th. I'm sorry, you were saying May 30th. I was like, yeah. What? Okay.
No.
Okay. So I'd say first week of May. I know it's a tight line, but I just don't think, I don't know.
I would say May 17th. Tuesday, May 17th.
I'd rather earlier if we can do it earlier.
Okay. I like the idea of a Tuesday, just I think people think of Tuesdays as election days, but I'm not stuck on it. May 3rd, May 10th. I don't know. I like the 10th. The first week in May makes me nervous.
Yeah, I hear you, Dorothy.
Everything that needs to be done in April and with, you know, Easter and Passover in April, and kids are, you know, have a week off school then, and you know,
the 10th.
I mean, we need to be able to, you know, communicate thoroughly with the public on this.
Okay, so I'm going to take that as a can you make that a motion in motion format, Dorothea?
I move that we schedule the bond vote for Tuesday, May 10th, 2022.
I'll second that.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Oh, I'm sorry. I have one question.
Yeah.
How is that? How are the absentee votes affected by this date?
The absentee votes, there's a certain, I forget how far it is before that date. There's definitely time to have them be out before that. I think it's about a month before there's that they start going out. So that would be in early April, which that's 2 weeks from now.
And they, with that new system, that vote scanning system, they're able to tabulate absentee votes much quicker than they have in the past.
And do we know where the absentee votes would be it obtained? Do they would people have to come to the library to get an absentee vote?
The BOE, as the agency running our the BOE will do that for us. They'll take care of absentee stuff. Board of Elections will.
Okay.
Can we have absentee ballots available at the library?
You can have absentee applications available, not ballots.
Okay.
The ballots must come directly from the Board of Elections, but we can have the applications which get submitted to then have them send you directly the absentee ballot. Yeah. And the reason that happens is that you get both an absentee ballot and the return envelope.
Okay.
Wouldn't the Board of Elections have a list of people who are absentee ballot people?
Yes, all permanent absentee ballots.
Permanent absentee. We'll get,
right. Permanent only.
We'll get them. We'll get them. So permanent ones will get them automatically. Right. And people can file for temporary absentee ballots for this election by picking up an absentee ballot applicant or absentee ballot request form from either the BOE or from us at the library, because we can have many places. We can add them up personally if we want to too.
And they can be downloaded, I think, too.
Yes, they can.
Website.
Yep.
Board of Elections and ours. But I mean, the absentee ballot thing is another reason why I'm glad we voted for May 10th instead of a week
ago. Just more time to make sure that happens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do we have the exact bond amount? We've already voted on the exact bond amount, right?
We do. Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions on this? Roz?
I'm just thinking about when the paper is published, how much time. Sometimes I think negative things come in and all of a sudden people are informed and upset. That happened many years ago. And having the information in earlier or the day before and earlier would be really important.
Well,
people forget.
I mean, the Hudson Valley one still comes out on Wednesday, late Wednesday.
So,
But I mean, we're saying if we have the election on a Tuesday, are you talking about the day of the election or?
Well, that means it's the further Wednesday. I like your idea of it being on Tuesday, but what about Thursday? The paper's out, it's got all the information. They're excited, they vote.
I think, I don't know, people who get it in the mail don't get it depending what time they get their mail on Thursday.
It's a little.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, maybe we should make it that Thursday then. I don't know.
Well, it just means everything has to be the paper by May 3rd, right? I mean, you have to be ahead of
the
week prior. Right. And I think that's right.
Headline. It's going to be in the paper for several weeks. There's going to be
building up. Yes.
It's going to be building.
And I think the other thing is to see if we can get it in the Freeman also, which comes out daily.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so I believe the motion is still on to have it on May 3rd. Is that correct?
No, May 10th.
May 10th.
10th. Sorry. Thank you for my brain went south there. So motion to have the bond vote on May 10th.
We did that, and it was seconded.
We did that already.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm tired. It's been a long day. All in favor. All in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None opposed. Thank you. Okay. That is done. Congratulations. And I got to find my agenda again. Thank you for putting it up. Any new business? I haven't seen any new business. Any public be heard?
Yeah, over here.
Okay, it's okay, right?
Hey. Yes. Should I speak? Oh. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Gary. Yeah, I just want to ask a quick question. With the movement of this other $20,000 for the needed environmental stuff and the previous money spent for the contract deposit, et cetera, will all the monies that have been spent toward moving toward 10 Dixon Avenue that came from the regular fund and then got moved to capital and then got, you know, spent for these mini expenses, how will that money be handled when you're coming to the total cost for the bond? Is that money to be paid back into the general fund?
Yes.
Yes, that's the intention.
Yes.
So the intention is to pay that money back into the general fund?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay,
great.
So, and if I may speak, I'm here. Just want to say I appreciate all that the library is doing and everything, Jeff, you said about the MOU sounds like a perfect plan. And everything sounds very solid. So thanks to you and to everybody for all the great work that you're doing on it.
Thank you, Laura.
Thanks, Laura.
Thank you.
Any other public be heard? Okay, I will
motion to adjourn.
I think Barry made the motion to adjourn. Is there a second? Howard, Howard's gonna go first. All in favor of adjourning?
Bye.
Okay, thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Night. Night, everyone.
Night.
Night.
Good night.
Good night.